All right, good morning. Welcome to First Baptist Church of Turbeville. It's an honor and privilege to be here this morning with each and every one of you. Here, bring them here. Bring them here. Sorry, I forgot something on my desk. Thank you, buddy. So I hope you all are as excited as I am to be in the house of the Lord this morning. So let's begin our worship service with a word of prayer. Father, thank you so much for bringing us all here this morning, God, and thank you for those that are watching online. God, as we navigate this worship service, God, as we navigate through our hearts worshiping you, God, I just pray that you impress upon us what you want us to hear, what you want us to learn. God, as we sing, I pray that we sing with abandon, God. I just pray that we give you everything that we've got. There's a reason why it says sing with a joyful noise and not in tune. And so, God, just be with us this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Oh, that was terrible. I'll try again. Good morning. Yeah, I'm one of these people. All right, y'all stand up. We're going to sing 605 in the Sweet By and By, and we'll sing all three verses.
Is fairer than day.
As we have our children's time, so all the children are invited to come forward and sit down and listen to what Cousin Sydney has.
Oh, yeah. All right. All right. Y'all come sit up in front of me where I can see you, please. I'd like to see your faces. Yeah, happy birthday. You had a good day yesterday?
Yeah.
Grandma's
birthday.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
Oh, are you going to make a cake for her?
Yeah. Guess what? I got my birthday coming.
The what? Okay. That sounds exciting. Well, I have something for y'all this morning. No, it's not a rat trap. Not this time. I'm sorry. What does this look like? It's a truck. It does, don't it? Y'all see it? What does it look like, Wade? It's a truck book. It says Haynes Repair Manual, based on a complete tear down and rebuild. Mr. Tyler, he has a truck kind of like this, and he asked if he could buy this book, because, you know, we have a joint account, and we have to, anyway. But anyway, why do you think he bought this book?
Because he had to repair his car if it...
But we just bought it.
Yeah. How could something be broken when you just bought it?
That's the question.
Because probably it would be winter time when he gets it, and then he drives...
We already got it. It's right there in the parking lot.
No.
Yeah. Why do you think he bought this book?
I don't see it.
Say that again.
Help him repair the truck.
But it ain't broke right now, dude. Good job. To repair a lawnmower. Does that look like a lawnmower? Crazy.
Yeah.
All right. Let me see your eyes. Let me see your cool eyes. Let me see you. Let me see you. I see you. Okay, I see you. I see you too. All right. Sawyer hit on it, didn't he? He said when the truck tears up, he has this to help him. Because to help him figure it out himself, you know? And I thought that was a pretty good investment. I mean, if you say so myself. But anyway. Can you think you know where I'm going with this? Do you think that in life you might have some times where you might hit up some problems?
Yeah, you like have a pothole and then your tire gets flat. You have to find a way to get it unflat.
Well.
Well,
if he has, I mean, yeah. All right, let's listen. What you saying?
So probably in a couple of months or years, it'll probably break down. And
yeah.
Repair it again.
That is the law of entropy you just said there, sir. It's the second, third law of thermodynamics. Everything goes into chaos. Anyway, hey, I'm back to you guys now. Yeah. Yeah, everything... You're going to have problems in life. In life, right? Not talking about the trucks. We're just talking about in life. You think you might have a few problems?
Yes.
Yeah, you think so? What do you think our manual repair for some problems in life? What is? Do you think we have a repair manual for our life?
No.
But we do have God to help us.
The Bible.
God's like our...
We do have a repair manual, don't we? Say it again, Connor.
The Bible.
Do you believe that?
Yes.
That's very good, because there might be some bumps down the road where you don't see, you don't know what to do. So something that's a little bit wiser than me is sure the Bible. And I got a verse. Hey, sit up. And I have a verse that kind of says it. Does any of y'all want to read it? You read it? Okay. Yes, you do. You can read one verse and you can read another one, okay? Come on. All right. I got two. Y'all get y'all next Sunday. Come here. You skip? Okay, you want to do it? All right, come on. And you can read after him. All right. What book of the Bible are we in, Colby?
We call it Possum.
Possum. That's okay. It's Psalms. It's got a P in it. It don't seem right? But we didn't make up the rules for spelling, did we? Yeah. But that's good. This is the book of Psalms. What chapter are we in?
19.
Y'all listen now. We're in chapter 19. All right. We're going to start in verse 7. Is it okay if I pick up my microphone a little bit so everybody can hear you? All right. Let's start in verse 7 here. Y'all listen now.
The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The
testimony
of the Lord, sure.
Yep.
Making wise the simple.
Let's read this one too.
The precepts.
The precepts.
The precepts of the Lord are right, rejecting.
Rejoicing.
Rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is
pure. Yep.
Pure.
Enlightening the eyes.
Good job. Those were some big words. Good job.
Preston, you want to read the last couple? All right. I'll make sure everybody can hear you, okay? Let's read verse 9 and 10 here.
The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The rules of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired they
are
than gold. Even much fine gold. Sweeter than honey.
That's pretty sweet.
And drippings of the honeycomb.
Did y'all hear that? It's sweeter than candy. And that's your favorite part of children's sermon.
This here is just what he just read says, sweeter than honey and drippings of the honeycomb. Anyway, what's our repair manual for the life? What's the book? The Bible. All right, so something stuck with y'all then. That's good. Anyway, all right, y'all, let's fold her. All right, let me see your eyes. Let me see your eyes. Charlotte, let me see your eyes.
I'll give you the fish eye.
I see your eyes. All right, let's fold our hands. All right, let's pray tonight, okay? Dear Lord, thank you so much for giving us a repair manual for our lives, because you know that when some of these things that hit us, it's like the blind leading the blind, Lord. I thank you for your word, and there are certainly times in my life where I found it sweeter than candy, sweeter than honey. And I pray for these kids, and I pray for our church as we try to teach them your word, Lord. Help us raise them in you, and in your name I pray. Amen. Now your favorite part.
Candy!
All right, y'all don't. All right. All right, here's your Snicker bar. All right, you get one. Get one. All right. Hold on, be patient.
Boy, go away. So, of course, Sydney had to ask Colby to read Psalms when this morning they had their Bibles in the truck, so I was having them read Romans 8:28, John 3:16, which, by the way, thank you so much to all the teachers, because both of them spouted it from memory. And so that's just a testament to this church and the teachers that are here, so thank you. So I told them, you know, look up, it's after Psalms, the book of Proverbs. So all of a sudden I hear Colby go, Psalm, possum. And then Dylan, Connor, and I made fun of Colby for about 10 minutes after that, because that's how we roll. But I was waiting for him. I was like, please don't let it be Psalms. Please don't let it be song. And it was the book of possum. So now you all know what we call the book of Psalms in the Glosson household. So thank you, Sydney, for that. We have quite a bit going on. So this evening we have our graduation service. We have 5 graduates, John, David, and Annabelle from kindergarten. We have Michaela and Emily from high school / college. And then we got Thomas from college, and his mom is making him come tonight. So please come tonight and enjoy the service. Should be about 30 minutes. Then afterwards, we're going to have food and inflatables for the end of year Awana Bash. So I'm looking forward to Kenneth and Hazel sliding down the slide. We're going to reenact that. I keep telling them that. They don't believe me. So please come tonight, bring kids. We want them to know more about our church, more about Awanas. We want them to have fun and learn about Jesus. So the more the merrier this evening, but we're going to start right here in the sanctuary, everybody, for our little graduation service. So please join us. Nominating committee nominations. If you are not here Wednesday night, please come and get one of these, or the deacons can hand you one, or I can have them at the back of the service. But those are due Sunday, the 6th of June. So there's names that you need to nominate for the nominating committee. Please grab one of those. Deacon nominations, you know, it's that time of year. They're going out on the 6th of June. So the date these are due back, the deacon nominations will be going out. So please be mindful of all the things we have going on. Then on Wednesday, the 2nd of June, we have a special business meeting. So I would think if you're a member, you would want to be here as we're going to be discussing two very important, not issues, but topics. And if you'd like to know more, please talk to one of the deacons and they'd be able to explain it. We had some birthdays. Maddie Floyd was on Tuesday. And then we had Sophie Blow on Friday. Delaney turned 4 yesterday. She had a blast. And then Peter Surrett today. Am I saying that name right? For those of you who know it. Okay, good. But yeah, Delaney has so much fun yesterday that about 6:50, she looks at me and goes, "Daddy, I want my Chewies. I'm ready to go to bed." And that little girl put herself to bed. So she's 4 going on 40. Tells us what to do. So if you see those folks that had a birthday, please wish them a happy birthday. We also have an anniversary. Seth and Amy, when was their anniversary? Yesterday. Yeah, I remember sending them a text. So yesterday was their anniversary, so they're out celebrating. They'll be here tonight. So when you see them tonight, wish them a happy anniversary. They've been married, what, 30 years? Yeah, about that. All right. So we have tons of things that we need to be in prayer for, tons of people. Mandy Morgan, as she just recently found out she has cancer. That's Whitney's cousin. Family of Jimmy Barino, he just passed away. Family of Wilbur Strickland, that's Betsy May's nephew and Ann's cousin. I was just going to say Betsy Ann, just to get both of you. Matt Coker, he had gallbladder surgery while he was in the hospital, got COVID. However, the news is he's good from COVID, but it's extended his hospital stay. So please pray for Matt Coker. Mutt. That's right. Thank you. Thank you. Jay. Mutt Coker. My writing's not the best. So Mutt Coker, everybody knows. Jimmy Rowe, my grandfather, they found a mass in his kidney. So he's going to have surgery on 7th of June. So please be in prayer for that. My mom's going to go and help take care of him after the surgery. Pray for end-of-year exams for our students. Academy, their last day of school is this Wednesday. But then the rest of the schools, the public schools, go till June 4th or something. 11th, wow. So anyway, just pray for all the students that are taking end-of-year exams, state exams, finishing school. Pray for the teachers and the students as another year is in the books and a difficult year it was. For all those involved. So at this time, the altar is open. If you would like to come forward and pray during our deacon prayer time, you may come forward and pray, or you can pray right where you're at. So I'd like to ask Deacon Chair Coach Austin Floyd to come forward and pray.
Pray. Lord, we thank you for another opportunity to come in your house this morning and to spend time together and focus on your word and worshiping you. Lord, we have a number of people that we bring before you this morning that are suffering from sickness, are experiencing a loss in a family or a friend, and they're struggling. Lord, we pray that you just put a hand of protection over them and comfort them in the only way that you know how. And if there's an opportunity for us to share a kind word or just someone to listen to and for you to use us, Lord, I pray that we'll be ready. Lord, I pray for our church this morning. We've got big deal going on tonight with people going through different phases in life, and you've obviously allowed that to happen, and we praise you for that, Lord. Lord, continue to be with us, and in my field especially, a lot of teachers and students are finishing up their years, Lord, and I pray just that you'll give them the strength and courage and willpower as it may be needed to finish out these last couple weeks, Lord, and it may seem like it will never end. And Lord, I hope that we just don't lose sight that there's always an opportunity, even here at the end of the year, to be a witness to someone. Lord, just continue to be with us throughout the remainder of this service, Lord. Be with Brother Ryan hiding behind the cross. I pray that we're receptive to the words that you've laid on his heart, and that you will use him as a tool for your kingdom. Lord, just continue to go with us throughout this day and come back tonight and be excited to celebrate and worship together. We pray these things in your name. Amen.
We're going to start with 411, come just as you are, and then we will switch over to 450. We will sing in 411, we'll do verse 1, verse 2, and then we'll go down to the bridge, and we'll go back up and sing verse 1 again. So you guys stand and sing with me, please. Turn over to 450. We'll sing through both verses. Thank you so much for the week we've had, for all the ways you took our hand, for all the ways you got us through the moments that were not the easiest to smile at. Lord, we just thank you for all the ways that you guide us, for all the ways that you've tried to prepare us, and even when we can't find our bearings, Lord. We know that we can always call on you, Lord. We know that you've given us your word. And there we can find peace and direction. Lord, we pray for those that are sick, for those that are lost, Lord. We pray that you become the beacon in their life. Lord, we pray that we are open to the moments you give us to be the salt and the light, Lord, to be you and to guide others to you, to be your hands and feet, Lord. And we thank you for those that you've put in our path this week and in our lives that have pointed us towards you, Lord. We just pray that you help us continue to seek you, to find you, to hear you, Lord. Help us be still in those moments that the human part of us wants to run, sometimes to scream, Lord. We just pray that we can feel your hand, feel your presence, Lord, in those moments, and that in through it all that you receive all the glory. Lord, we just pray as we move through this week that we find every reason to praise you and to say thank you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Nicole and Ann. I appreciate it. Something I forgot to mention was pray for those that are traveling, as Melba and Martin are out in South Dakota. Oh, Martin, you're here. I was told to pray for y'all because you're traveling. Well, I'll tell you what, you can't get good help nowadays. So Martin didn't go with Melba? Pray for Melba as she's out traveling. So then that's my fault because I assumed that Martin was with her. So Martin's been having a blast. But pray for Melba as she's traveling, as well as I know some folks have some family members that are going to be coming in town soon. So just pray for traveling mercies for all those that are involved. So this morning, as I was reading this week, something really struck me in this passage in Judges, because I believe that we are facing this today. And if we believe and we know that the book, the Bible, is God's inerrant word, everything that's written in it is to help us, then I think this is very important. So where we find ourselves this morning is Joshua has passed away. Prior to that, Joshua stood up there, told the children of Israel about how God is a jealous God, that they must obey him, that they must not worship idols, that they must not do this, they must not do that. And of course, the children of Israel kept saying, "We will never do that. We wouldn't do that." And then we find ourselves now in Judges chapter 2, verses 10 through 15. So we went from past to present. And the reason that is because it talks about how Joshua died to the generation after him. Because remember, only Joshua and Caleb were of the generation that got into the promised land. So now the generation after Joshua and Caleb have died away. They've gone to be with their fathers, which means they have passed, and their children have turned back to idols, worshiping idols, and doing wicked and evil in the sight of the Lord. And so the question that we must ask ourselves this morning is, why is that? Why did they go to that after that generation died? Because I don't care what generation you're in, if you're a Christ follower, it is on us to teach the next generation. It's on us to share with the next generation. See, many a times we get comfortable, right? We go to church, we do our thing, we do our tithes, we do this, we do that. And the next thing you know, the church isn't what it used to be. Was that because we have relied on the church, the Sunday school teachers, to teach our kids what it means to be a Christian, what it means to be a Christ follower, the importance of assembling together, the importance of giving joyfully? Or did we spend time at home and teach our youngins and teach the next generation what this means? So this morning we're going to read from Judges chapter 2, starting in verse 10. And all that generation also were gathered to their fathers. And there arose another generation after them who did not know the Lord or the work he had done for Israel. And the people of Israel did what was evil in the sight of the Lord and served the Baals. And they abandoned the Lord, the God of their fathers, who had brought them out of the land of Egypt. They went after other gods from among the gods of the people who were around them and bowed down to them. And they provoked the Lord to anger. They abandoned the Lord and served the Baals and the Ashtaroth. So the anger of the Lord was kindled against Israel, and he gave them over to plunderers who plundered them, and he sold them into the hand of their surrounding enemies, so that they could no longer withstand their enemies. Whenever they marched out, the hand of the Lord was against them for harm, as the Lord had warned and as the Lord had sworn to them, and they were in terrible distress. So something that's also unique is in the first chapter of Judges, we see all these tribes of Israel going out and fighting certain people, and every time you can see that they didn't push everyone out like Joshua did in Joshua's battles. So the Lord was already setting up because he knew that the children of Israel were not going to be able to be obedient. But I do believe that it's important just to go back to Joshua chapter 24. Verses 16 through 18, because this is what Joshua was talking about. The same thing that we see the children of Israel facing in Judges chapter 2, 10 through 15, Joshua is warning them about. So in Joshua 24, 16, it says, "Then the people answered, 'Far be it from us that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods. For it is the Lord our God who brought us and our fathers up from the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, who did great signs in our sight and preserved us in all the way that we went and among all the peoples through whom we pass. And the Lord drove out before us all the peoples, the Amorites who lived in the land. Therefore, we also will serve the Lord, for he is our God.'" So this is the generation that we see has now passed in Judges chapter 2. So what happened between that generation and the next? What happened between that generation and the next? I believe one of the things is, you know, when something is new, we're excited about it. I mean, when we're first saved, we're on fire for God, we're ready to take any mountain, right? And then as you've been saved a while, not that it gets dull and not that it's not exciting, but you're saved. You know, what's next? How do I continue to keep that fire? Well, see, that's the problem with the children of Israel in this time. The generation prior didn't pass on that fire. Didn't teach their children what it meant to serve God in the Old Testament. Who did they rely on to teach them? It seems like nobody, right? It seems like the folks that they couldn't run out of the promised land. Because what happened? As soon as they passed, what did their children do? They started worshiping and serving other gods. I believe the first sign of a generation that has gone astray is the worshiping of idols. What do I mean by that? Turn on YouTube. Everybody on YouTube is rich, has a nice Maserati or a Tesla, or but the idol, the god that they serve is money and fame. I saw somebody the other day on Facebook posted, and I agree 100%. Instead of having 16 and pregnant, which there is a show on MTV called 16 and Pregnant, why don't you have 25 and married and stable? Right? Because what it's done now is we have generations of kids who have watched this on TV and think it's cool. So guess what they're doing? To get their 15 minutes of fame. See, the generation is lost. They're worshiping idols. They're not worshiping God. And if they're not worshiping God, do you think the next generation is going to worship God? Or do you think they're going to go even deeper into their sin? They're going to go even deeper into their sin. So they went for the other gods. They went to the gods of those who are around them, which means the other thing that happens is they go to the world. Because God has not been shared with them, the true God, the God of the Bible, the God of Joshua was not shared to the next generation. So what happened? They started looking elsewhere for fulfillment. They started looking elsewhere for joy. See, many a times what we do is we come to church and we believe that if you get saved, there's got to be a certain way that you got to act immediately. There's a certain thing that you have to do. And many a times that pushes people away from the church. I want you to stay with me here. When Jesus called the disciples, did he say, change everything about yourself and follow me? He said, follow me, right? James and John, hotheads, they wanted to burn down a city because they wouldn't accept them. Now, they got rebuked, but they were still who they were. Judas Iscariot still betrayed Jesus. See, many a times as a church, we face people that come in and we know what we know. So to be a Christian, you need to make sure you tithe 10%, make sure you sing hymns. And thank God we're not like this, but you got to wear a three-piece suit. That's how I was raised. And so when people walk in and they see everybody dressed nice and maybe all they have are a nice pair of slacks or blue jeans and a t-shirt, they don't feel comfortable. See, we don't share the love of God. They did not share the love of God with the next generation. They were so comfortable and they were so happy with the way their life was that they just let their kids do whatever. And so what happens when the generations are not following God? We're a church, so we can say that in here. And that's what's happening in our world. When generations are not following God, as we see in Deuteronomy, what happens? The Lord gets angry. God gets angry. I mean, would you say that our world is in a mess? Would you say that our churches are a mess? That's because we have not done a good job of sharing the gospel and sharing the love of Jesus Christ to the next generation. And so here's what happens. The anger of the Lord was kindled against Israel, and he gave them over to plunderers who plundered them, and he sold them into the hand of their surrounding enemies so that they could no longer withstand their enemies. And it continues, and whenever they went out, he was not with them. You know, many times we ask ourselves, why is this happening or why is that happening? Because God's not in it. God's not in it. We have removed God from everything and implanted anything that the world tells us is right. We're afraid to call out sin because we don't want to be called a bigot. We don't want to be called a racist in some circles. We don't want to be called certain things. Nobody wants to be labeled, right? I sure don't want to be labeled. And if you tell me that I'm some way, I'm going to do the opposite to try and get you to believe I'm not, even though I am. It's human nature. But we have removed God from society. We have removed God from this world. And then we wonder why it's a mess. We wonder why it's a mess. I've got some statistics and I've got some numbers that I think are just telling of our society. So we have the largest generation gap in American religion in history. So the silent generation, which was born 1928 to 1945, 84% identified as Christian. 4% identified as non-Christian faith, and 10% as unaffiliated. Baby boomers, 1946 to 64, and this is a Pew Research poll that was done in 2019. Baby boomers, 1946 to 1964, 76% Christian, 6% non-Christian faith, and 17% unaffiliated. Generation X, 1965 to 1980, 67% Christian, 6% non-Christian faith, that didn't change, 25% unaffiliated. Millennials, 1981 to 1996, 49% Christian, less than half. Less than half. 9% non-Christian faith and 40% unaffiliated or nuns. So then let's go down and go a little bit deeper as it talks about how many times they attend church service. The silent generation, 1928 to 1945, 50% said they attended weekly or more. 10% once or twice a month, 13% a few times a year, 12% seldom, and 12% never. Baby boomers, 1946-64, 35% attended weekly or more, 13 once or twice a month, 18 a few times a year, 18% seldom, and 14% never. Generation X, 1965 to 1980, 32% weekly or more, 15% once or twice a month, 21% a few times a year, 17% seldom, and 15% never. Now millennials, 1981 to 1996, 22% weekly or more. So we went from 32 to 22%. We dropped 10% just between Generation X and millennials. 13% once or twice a month, 22% a few times a year, 20% seldom, and 22% never. So what does that say about the church? What does that say about the previous generation of Christians? I mean, if we're honest with ourselves, we have not done a good job of going out and loving our neighbor. We have not done a good job of teaching the next generation. I have been guilty of it. Get so overwhelmed. My kids are in Awanas. They're in this. Man, they got it. They're going to teach them what they need to know. I need a break. But see, that's not what we're called to do. Matter of fact, everything that the kids, that your children, that the next generation should know about Jesus should come from learning in the home and by example of the parents, the grandparents, great-grandparents, whoever's there. That's where the burden lies. But see, for far too long, we have relied on the church to be that. Well, the church can only do so much. The church can only do so much. I can spank my kids. I can't spank yours. The church can only do so much. We have removed Christ out of everything. We have removed Christ out of everything. So where is the best place for your children to learn about Jesus? Where is the best place for the next generation to learn about Jesus? Home. Home. So how many of us, and I am guilty of this, so I'm looking in the mirror, I'm not looking out the window, and I don't want you to raise your hands, but how many of us spend one night a week with our children, teaching them about Jesus, teaching them about the importance of church, the gathering together? And when I say church, I'm talking about the body of Christ, not the building. Teaching them about why it's important to give. And not just money. Give your time. Give your abilities. Your skills. How many of us spend that time with our families or our children, the next generation? Or do we just put a tablet in front of them? Or do we just put them in front of the TV? My favorite thing when I'm tired and the kids are bouncing off the wall, I'm like, hey, what do y'all want to watch? I try to find a cartoon for them to watch, right? It's not always the right thing to do. But see, much like the children of Israel that we see in the book of Judges, we are no different today. We are no different today. All you have to do is turn on the TV. All you have to do is turn on the TV. Sin is glorified in commercials. Sin is glorified in TV shows. Sin is glorified in the schools. Sin is glorified everywhere, and it shouldn't be glorified in our home. Our kids need to know about the death, the burial, the resurrection, why that's so important. See, because everything in the Bible points to Jesus Christ. Everyone knows that, right? Everything in the Bible points to Jesus Christ. The Old Testament, especially like here, it points to the need of Jesus Christ, because obviously the Israelites could not keep the Ten Commandments. Matter of fact, they broke the first two right here, worshiping idols. Everything points to the need of Jesus Christ. So do our kids know why Jesus Christ is important? Do they know how and why we know that he is real? That he came down and lived a perfect 33 years? Because there's proof. There's evidence. Yes, some of it is by faith. I understand that. But do we give them the concrete information that they need to be able to go out into this world and stand tall and say, I'm a Christ? I'm a believer in Jesus Christ. Or do we just send them out there unprepared so that when they hear about things in school, they don't know how to respond? When they're faced with situations, they don't know how to act. So it's easier to be like the children of Israel and do what everyone else is doing, or stand strong in your faith. See, I worry about these upcoming generations. And that's because I have seen way too many young men and women who are just strong in their faith in high school. And then they go to college, and all of a sudden, they do a 180. And you could never tell that they knew Jesus. You could never tell they used to lead Sunday school. You could never tell that they were a believer. Why is that? I think there's three things. I do. One, the teaching is not deep enough. We're just scratching the surface with them because we think that the kids won't understand. The teaching is not deep enough. They're not getting it from home. There's nobody in their house saying, hey, this is what you believe and this is why you believe it. They're getting it all from the church. So as soon as the church is no longer there to babysit them, they go off on their own. They go off on their own. And number three, there's too much pressure on them to perform. Think about that. I know of one young lady who used to have to go to other church youth events just to not be in charge, because every time she showed up at her church events, they'd put her in charge of something. She was in charge of a class. She was in charge of making sure that they met. She's in high school. Let her be a kid. So it's important. I'm saying all this to say that it's important that if we have any hope of fixing this, it has to start now. It has to start now. Things look bleak, I know. Trust me, I turn on the news, I watch, I read the paper. I am in fear for my kids because of the things that are coming about in laws and legislation. The attack on Christianity and the beliefs that we hold. Just recently, I saw that appellate court in a state, and I can't remember the state, a private Christian school, because Biden, one of his executive orders or whatever, said that they have to accept transgender and they have to call them by their new pronoun. And the school said, well, we're a private Christian school, we should be exempt from that. And the state and the appellate court said, no, you're not. Now, do I believe that we'll get to the Supreme Court and it'll probably be overturned? Sure. But what I'm saying is, it's coming. It's already happening. There is a legal team out there called the Freedom From Religion. Mikey Weinstein runs it. I watched a YouTube video the other day, and they had on a former Christian musician, a pretty famous one, that decided he was no longer a Christian. I watched one where they had Ronald Reagan Jr. on there. And I don't know if some of you, Keith pointed it out to me, so I did some research and I watched it. He has a commercial where he said he's happy to go to hell. This is Ronald Reagan Jr. Yeah. So this is the world that we're facing. We're getting bold attacks from the enemy. So my question is, do we sit in the church and allow the next generations to just flounder in it? Or do we do what we need to do and teach them what they need to know to be able to withstand it? Because there's nothing worse than talking to someone and not that is not a believer and not having some sort of tangible answer to give back to them. I was having a conversation one time with an atheist. We were in Afghanistan, and he was an officer. I was enlisted. And one of the verses in the Bible he went to was when the young children or young men were making fun of Elijah because he was bald. And the mother bear come out and ate the kids is what he said. Well, if you look at it in context, those were soldiers. Those weren't like little baby kids running around that were making fun of them. But I had to go do some research to find out exactly what he was talking about. See, our enemy knows the Bible better than some of us. Our enemy's kids know the Bible better than some of us. I say our enemy. We know who our real enemy is. But are we going to leave the next generations like the children of Israel left the next generation in the book of Judges? Or are we going to understand that there has never been a time like now that we as the church, the body of Christ, must unite? We as the church, the body of Christ, must ensure that the next generation is ready for the battle that is to come. Because some, if not all of us, are not going to be here for the worst. You know, I was in the military, and it would be like them just sending us over to Afghanistan with no weapons, with no ammo, with no battle rattle, which is the Kevlar vests and helmets and all that. I mean, that's what we're doing to our kids. We're pushing them out into the world, not giving them the armor of God. So no wonder why they go and worship the God of fame, the God of money, the God of electronics, the God of whatever sport. I mean, the God of drugs. Anything that takes the place of God in our lives is an idol. That could be a lot of things. So as a church this morning, I want us to pray, and I want us to think, and I want us to rejuvenate ourselves and get ready and to prepare the next generation to get ready for the fight that is here and that is going to come. Because the church is supposed to be about action. The church is supposed to be about action. And one of the ways that we can prepare and get ready is by doing things like tonight, where we have kids come in and they learn about Jesus Christ. Where we do things that will bring people in. I mean, I hear all sorts of stories about cool things y'all used to do. Why don't we do those types of things anymore? When did we get tired? When did we get fed up? When did we no longer have fun doing church? Because if you're waiting on the next generation or the generation after to do it, if you didn't show them how to do it, how can you expect them to do it? And I believe that is where we are at, not just First Baptist Church of Turberville, the church, the body of Christ as a whole. We have sat back too long and waited for the next generation to take over, but how can they take something over if they don't know how to do it? If they don't know how to do it. So this morning, as the musician comes to play, I want us to pray that God show us, that God give us the strength, that God give us the people in our lives that we need to train. Because I'm here to tell you, I do get worried at the end of the school year every year because there's kids that don't get any type of love, don't hear about anything other than hate, except for at school. And here we sit, we meet every Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, and we got other days in the week. We could have things here for kids to come and get food because some of them may not only eat but once a day. In their home. So as the musician plays, just bow your head and close your eyes and pray that God gives us the strength and the wisdom and the knowledge to know what to do, what to say, how to train these future generations to be the warriors that we once were. Yes, it's a different world. Yes, it's a scarier world. But God doesn't change. God hasn't changed. His call on us has not changed. So as I see it this morning, we have two choices. One, we can just let it continue and continue to push these kids and these next generations out to figure it out on their own, like the children of Israel did in Deuteronomy, or we can step up to the plate as we're commanded by God. And I hope this morning that as we step up to the plate, and families teach their kids what it means to be a Christian and not expect the church to do it all. Thank you so much for being here this morning. I look forward to tonight, graduation service. Please be here, 6 o'clock. We'll spend about 30 minutes in here, and then we'll go down there and eat and get to bounce in some bounce houses and play. I'm looking forward to that. So if you see a kid walking down the street, tell them about it. If you know of somebody who just needs to get out of the house, parents need a break, tell them about it. Let's get them to the house of the Lord where we can love on them. And tell them about Jesus and start them on that journey. And you know what? If you don't have kids, if you don't have grandkids, find a kid that needs love, because there's tons of them out there. Tons of them out there. So come tonight so we can celebrate with Thomas and the others on their graduation. And I'm looking forward to it. I have the nominating committee nomination card, so I'll be back there at the end of the service. So please, if you weren't here Wednesday night and you're a member, come grab one so you can have it to turn in on June 6th or before, whenever you put it on there. So I pray that everyone has a blessed rest of their day. And I would like to ask, Richard's behind me, so I can't ask him. Martin, you mind praying for us?